David, this is Ham Radio Now, episode, what is this already? 347. And it is the most important amateur radio program on the internet. You know, Jerry Ellsworth gave me some shade for saying that.
Yeah, I heard. I watched. I was jealously watching.
And I was so tired that I did not have a comeback. I just said, it's something you can't challenge. And so immediately she said, well, I challenge it. And all right. I could do was repeat it.
And actually, you were lucky because she just kind of let it drop at that point.
She was gone. She was very nice to me. Yeah. Thank you, Jerry.
Yes, she was.
This is Ham Radio Now, the most important amateur radio program on the internet. And it is episode 347. You are in your Boy Scout uniform.
I am.
There's a reason for that.
There is.
Yeah. I'm going to title this one. What the heck is that behind you? There's like a huge monitor.
Well, you know, I've been trying to set the studio up so I can start doing some recording. So, you know, we had the whole Marty lesson last week and that's the result. And when the PC worked and didn't keep dropping me every 6 seconds, I actually could show I had the big Jamboree on the air logo ready to go. And
you're close.
Epic fail. Epic you fail.
Tried so hard.
I tried so hard.
So the official title for this episode, because no one could come up with anything better, is Old JOTA. And let's just bring everybody else on
onto
the system here, and we'll figure out why it's Old JOTA in just a minute. But I'm going to let you introduce everybody. You are in the upper left. So, let's go across the top row.
Yeah, I can't see anybody. So if we're looking at my top row, we'll start with Jim Wilson is on the top left on my top row.
Okay, Jim, you can wave at everybody. Cause
say hi, Jim.
Yay.
David is not looking at the feed I'm sending back to him. He hasn't learned how this show works yet.
It's on the other side of the screen. Well, I have got most of it down. and then all I've got is 85A in the middle. The top, say hi.
Yep, that's me.
And that will be yourself.
My Crownover AD5A.
All right,
awesome. And then on my right would be Bill Stearns.
Hey, Bill Stearns NE4RD.
Awesome. And in the bottom, Brian McDaniel.
Hi. Speak to us, Brian. So there's an audio audience out there that needs to know what your voice sounds like because they're not going to see your picture.
Good evening, Brian McDaniel N4AE.
Awesome. And then on the bottom left, I've got another group. So I assume that's where you are, Gary.
And you should make that picture your full screen.
That's the one. Okay. I can do that. Then, now we're there.
Yeah. Then you'll see what gets switched.
Yeah.
And I am partially cutting Brian's face off. There's not much I can do about that. Brian, there you go. That should be comfortable for the rest of the evening. So who wants to explain why we're calling this Old JOTA?
I think you'll have to do that, Gary, because that was you.
Because I made it up. Well, okay, JOTA is Jamboree on the Air, which you might be getting from all of these Boy Scout uniforms, except for me, because I'm not one. And JOTA is coming up the end of this month, the end of October, 21st and 22nd. It is... Jim, I believe that you keep explaining it as the largest Boy Scout activity of all time, period.
Well, the words I use are it's the largest scouting event in the world.
Okay.
And it's over 1 million scouts around the world participate.
All right. And it's coming up end of the month.
Yep.
And this is the 60th anniversary.
Is that why it's old, Gary?
And that's why it's old. That's why it's old JOTA. I mean, last year was pretty old.
It was 59 then. Yeah, it's actually the 20th, the 21st, and the 22nd because they start Friday night.
Okay.
Somewhere.
Cool. Yeah. It falls across my birthday. And just for members of the audience, large expensive presents, gratefully accepted. All right.
Yeah, hit the pig.
Yes, which reminds me, Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. If you enjoy our programs and stuff, stop by the website, hamradionow.tv. Send us money. Just click the pig. I've made the pig easier to find on the website. So click the pig. So guys, what I would like to do is get the press release out of the way pretty quickly, which is when is JOTA? When is JOTA? Which you've already said, but we can fill in a little more detail and how you do JOTA. And then I want stories. I want JOTA stories. So I'm assuming you guys have JOTA stories.
Yep.
So
I bet we do.
Jim, you want to do the press release?
Yeah, that's what I would do well, because these guys have the stories. They're out there with the scouts, and I suffer from altitude sickness working at the World Scout level and at the national level here in the U.S. But it is, as we noted before, it's the largest scouting event in the world. It's over a million scouts from 150 countries got on the air. It's actually 1.5 million got on the air, got on the internet during that weekend, the third weekend in October, every third weekend. And the objective is to help scouts understand that they're part of a worldwide scouting movement, and to meet people, could be across town, could be across the country, but ideally it's around the world, and understand there's cultural differences and they're just regular people out there to make the world smaller through scouting. When we put our ham radio hats on, it's all about the technology. But for scouting, it's about connecting scouts. So I try to tell also people, it's about conversations, scout-to-scout conversations rather than contacts. It's not a contest. It's getting on the air. It's scouts talking to scouts. So that's probably the press release.
So it sounds to me like the thrust of it is more scouts getting used to some technology and being able to talk to scouts around the world. And the ham radio part is just sort of the conduit.
Exactly. Ham radio and the internet, for Jamboree on the internet, that's the channel that is used for the scouts to communicate with one another. And along the way, they do. They pick up the technology. They pick up the fun and what I say, the magic of amateur radio. But absolutely right. It's about scouts talking to scouts.
So we don't mind putting some ham radio into it. I mean, we don't put a cover over the radio.
Absolutely.
It's radio forward.
In fact, we talked about it's an old event. It's 60 years old. Back in 1957, they came out of a jamboree having had an amateur radio operation on the air, and a guy named Les Mitchell said, why can't we do this every year? And he began, over a cup of coffee with a bunch of other ham radio operators, Jamboree on the Air. And it is. It's, you bet. It's about getting introduced to the technology and just the magic of amateur radio. Connecting to a scout someplace else and learning about what they're doing.
Is there an element in there of getting new hams out of the scouts?
Mm-hmm. I call it planting seeds. we watched it at the National Scout Jamboree that we were just out at. A lot of scout, 2,500 scouts came through our station, got on the air, learned what amateur radio was, and there was a few that came back every single day. There was one that came back, even though he broke his leg, he came back. And he was there every day and told me, this is a great hobby. I want to learn more about it. So
He didn't break his leg operating the radio.
No, no.
Because I was thinking, maybe it was like too aggressive on the foot switch.
That was probably on the zip line.
Yeah. I'm not. I think he just twisted his knee or something like that. Okay. But it didn't stop him from getting to the station. And there's no short distances at the Jamboree. It's quite a hike from the scout camps into the central part of the Jamboree where we were operating. So, it's planting seeds. Some of them they think it's interesting when they get to be 30 or 40 or 50, and they find some more time, they say, gee, I think I ought to try this out. It was pretty interesting back there. Others pick it up when they get home and do more with it. And some, it just bounces off. But that's what happens with seeds. So, it's an introduction.
So I suppose we ought to do a little bit of the mechanics. Because at this point, most of the scouting troops and most of the hams or ham clubs that are going to do this have probably got their plans laid. But it doesn't cover everywhere yet. It isn't everywhere. It can easily be expanded to more areas, lots more areas. So assuming somebody out there in the audience says, well, you know, I would like to help them out. What do they do?
Yeah, as a ham radio operator, what they could do is contact their local scout council, find out if there's an operation going on, see what their club is doing. And if they want to do something, they probably need to start a lot sooner than 2 or 3 weeks before. But it's best to connect with a troop or a pack, patrol or a den, somebody that they know, and set up a station and help them get on the air.
So it is pretty much too late for someone who wants to do it this year?
No.
I think there's other opportunities, and I've seen that before. I've been doing this for 6 years, and I think if you were an operator and you wanted to participate, if you go look at the ARL JOTA website, it has the frequencies, and you could get on the air and talk to a scout that's looking for someone, if you don't have time to set up a station and have that conversation.
Like I said, I didn't have any specific plans this year, and I got contacted last week by the local club member that said, hey, you know, we really want to get back involved in this the scouting, radio scouting thing, and we'd like to do Jamboree on the air. So I just sent out an email I put a flyer together just for, took me 5 minutes last week, and I sent it out to the district, and I said, hey, you know, we're going to stay at this city park here. We're going to set up a small station, maybe two HF units and a VHF unit, probably hooked into EchoLink, depending upon the band conditions. And we're just going to do it. And it's already been sent out to all the troops and packs in the area. I kind of said, hey, you know, this is really great for our Weeblos that need their arrow of light. This is an opportunity for them to hopefully talk to a scout in some other country. And I just literally started planning last week, and we have almost everything all together. I even have people calling in and making reservations right now. Cause we said, if you're going to bring more than 6 scouts, I need to know so I can have some more people show up so we can help kind of funnel them through the station and kind of give them a good information on amateur radio and what Jamboree on the Air is all about.
Okay, Jim, your troops are mutinying on you a little bit, at least in terms of how soon you got to start.
Never too late.
Never too late.
And that's great. I'm delighted to hear that. And as Bill mentioned, he was planning just to get on the air and hand out some QSOs. That's one of the challenges these Jamboree on the Air events have is making a contact. They need somebody on the other end of the QSO. Now, ideally, it's a group of scouts, but it needs to be somebody. And so if you can get on the air, the frequencies are published on the k2bsa.net site and the scouting.org/JOTA site. There are scout frequencies. So you can go to those frequencies. You can pick up some youth voices probably on there and make some contacts and help them out. So absolutely get on the air, hand out some contacts.
Okay. So that's the other side of the equation is getting hams out there to talk to scouts. Is it mostly scout group to scout group, or is it, where do us ordinary hams come in?
Can y'all hear me?
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay. I just want to add a few things here. You know, we talk about the scouting side of this, and it is hugely important. But, you know, one of the things we all talk about as old timers is where is the future of ham radio? And when you think about the opportunity, now this is globally, not just U.S., of 1,000 young scouts participating in a ham radio centered event, what an opportunity. And I think a lot of our clubs would be wise, if they have an interest in this area, to take on a project of putting on a JOTA event each year. I was reading a statistic the other day of, you know, our licenses are going up, but an alarming number of new licensees never get on the air. And I think that is where follow through from a JOTA event. Our particular event we're going to put on at my son's station, we're going to do a radio merit badge class with that. We'll also include local hams who are involved in scouting to be on the other end to ensure we have QSOs over the repeater if someone needs to hang out on 20 meters to make sure these kids have a great experience. And we certainly have the angle, certainly a participating scout to scout, but talk to as many people as you can. And if you can't organize a station, as others have said here, get on the air, 14290, plus or minus, and just find someone calling CQ and talk to boy after boy after boy if that's what they need. And that's what we can all do a little piece of to help ensure our future. Mm-hmm. I happened to be in Dayton at a CW Ops dinner, and I looked over there, and there sat Jim. And, you know, I thought, I didn't know he was in CW Ops. Well, we have an award in there about who did the most to promote ham radio to youth. And they chose to give that award to the Boy Scouts because of Jamboree on the Air, because of the radio merit badge, because of the recent Jamboree activities we had that exposed kids. Now, are they going to learn CW on the first day? No. But certainly they can hear it and listen to it. We had a kid at the Jamboree who I was operating CW for a bit, and I had to sneak around to do that. But I managed to find an open station and got a couple of kids to put on their headphones. And they were listening, and they, to my little bit to my surprise, they were very amazed and interested. And one of the kids, who he was not shy, said, "Let me try that." I said, you know how to do Morse code?" He said, "Just tell me. Just tell me how to do an A, and I'll..." He's ready to go. And so there are those boys, just like we were. When you think back what got you interested, it's the magic. It's, my goodness, let me get more of this. And you're not going to convert every boy, but you're not going to convert any of them if you don't expose them. And, mm-hmm. and I think JOTA is about that from the ham radio side. From the scouting side, there's so many other pieces to it of global fellowship and scouting movement and you know, troops talking to troops across the world, and that's certainly interesting. But I think from the ham radio side, the real value add here is getting kids exposed. And you'll find those 1 in 10 or 5 in 100, whatever the number is, someone probably knows, that will catch the fever. And then the second thing I would say, and I'm talking to ham radio clubs here, is as you get new hams, these young kids and Boy Scouts, they get the radio merit badge, and maybe they go through a license course. You know, Biofang radios cost, what, $29? Get to the club treasury and buy 10 of those things. And, you know, every time a kid in the organization that gets his license, give them a radio. It's a little alarming that these young people are getting licenses and not getting on the air. And that's easily fixed these days. So, anyway, that's sort of my soapbox, but I think JOTA has value. Both sides, the scouting movement, it's been going for 60 years. It's evolved to, as Jim said, the biggest scouting event, global scouting event that occurs in a year. But it also is a great way to find the kids that are interested in participating in our hobby.
Absolutely. Actually, I get the Baofengs for $12.
How do you do that?
You could get 40 of them.
Yeah, well, you know, that's what we do, is we get the ones with the little, just, you know, the 12 station ones, the 12 channel ones, because for $12, I don't care if they come back working or not working. And when we do the radio merit badge days, you know, here's a pair for you, and here's a pair for you, and here's a pair for you, and a pair for you, and they come back a little while after having played with them, and it's great.
I think one of the things also that we've seen is the education, you know. Let's be honest with you, seeing a handheld radio is sort of a leap in technology for these kids. You know, they're used to the cell phones, they're used to perhaps maybe the phone at their house, or obviously computers. but they've not run into HTs before or run into an HF station. And we find ourselves at our Jamboree of spending a little bit of time educating them about what they're about to do. Before you sit someone down at a single sideband station, that's a sound that most of these boys have never heard before. You know, they're used to hearing high quality CD quality FM sound with high fidelity, and now you're going into a bandpass of, you know, a couple of kilohertz. And so their interpretation, that how do they hear it? That, what did he say? And you have to sort of coach them along. And we found that the kids really do respond to the technology very, very quickly. But believe it or not, you know, it's something that's very foreign to them. This year, we are putting a fox hunt into our event, which is the first time we've done that. We've spent the better part of the summer learning how to make a fox hunt easy for a 10 or an 11-year-old. And believe it or not, it's been extraordinarily challenging to us because, you know, the technology goes back all the way to World War II as far as direction finding goes. But what are you here for? How do you use this radio? What are you looking for? What are you trying to find? And it is presenting itself with a challenge. And I think that even though the hobby is not necessarily extraordinarily complicated, to many of these young people, it is rocket science. And I think it's our job not only to give them a taste of the hobby, but also try to begin to explain to them how, you know, direction finding is actually the fundamental of the way your GPS works. And once you begin to give them the categories and show them how this technology relates, then they begin to actually make a connection and find it even more fascinating.
Before you get away from this topic too far, how did you solve the problem of making the fox hunt less complicated? What did you do?
Well, to be honest with you, we're still working it out. we started very, very simply. You know, most direction finding is going to be based on triangulation. So we actually went with more of a geocaching approach, which I think would be interesting to the kids. So we started off trying to find the fox ourselves. Then we began to work with, you know, yesterday, Saturday, we actually began to put 10-year-old and 11-year-olds that have never seen an HT antenna, they've never seen a loop before. We let them hear what they were looking for, and then we began to show them how to attenuate the signal, and every one of the kids found it. Once they got within about 20 feet, they actually started looking with their eyes rather than listening, but they found it nonetheless. And I think that we've still got a little ways to go before we iron it out, but at first we thought it would be something that we might be able to put older scouts that have their licenses in charge of, but now it's clear that we're going to need someone more experienced to help educate these boys along, to the point where we're going to record what the strong signal sounds like, one that's a little bit off center, one that's a little deviated, so that they can hear the difference, so that when they're out hunting for it, they would at least have an idea of what they're looking for or listening for.
Yeah, when I've done the field day stuff, same issue with understanding and tuning single sideband. Our GOTA operators sideband was a totally foreign concept. So understand what you're trying to do with them there. And I imagine the fox hunting stuff is all on foot. No one's driving around. Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you do the ARDF style, the orienteering style?
We do the orienteering style. Yes. Okay. And we've been very fortunate where Aero Antennas has actually donated a couple of loops to us so that we've been able to use those. But the that's the direction that we're going at. And we're also finding that the DMR helps us out a good bit. You know, I realize that a lot of folks may have some opinions on the technology behind DMR, but we look at it as contacting, you know, and I talk to the ham radio clubs here in the Chicago area at a great length and say, well, look, you know, well, how many people are you getting licensed? Well, no, my job is actually expose them to a new hobby, a new science and oriented engineering concept. I wouldn't expect a 14-year-old boy who gets a dentistry merit badge to be able to do a root canal. So I'm not a scouter to be able to come in and run, you know, an HF station. But when they get the experience to it, I think what Jim said earlier is that as they begin to see it, maybe they're going to come back to it in a few years. And that seed that we plant is vitally important.
So what else do you guys do in conjunction with just setting up some stations and setting the kids down? What peripheral activities or materials do you make as part of the JOTA operation?
I'm very fortunate in our group. We actually have two educators that are part of it. One's a ham and one is not. And if we were a field day station, we'd be running five out. That's typically the way we work. We run about 100 to 150 boys through the program every year. What they do is when they come in, because we're dealing with advancements, we give them a checklist. You've got to go to these particular places throughout the site. You have to be able to check that you've been there. We give them a sort of a small miniature log when they actually make contacts, but they have to answer a question about each one of the stations. So they may go to the HF phone station and they have to answer a question. Then they go to the PSK station and they answer a question. They go to the FM station. They go to the CW station. They go to the Fox Hunt. And when they come back with those things, then the scout commissioner signs off on the advancement of the people. So we actually give them, when you come to... Okay, so we're dumbing this down. We're making this relatable for 11 and 10-year-olds. So the sign that's above the HF station is we're talking to Europe. The sign that's above the FM station is we're talking to Chicago, so that they can see how different technologies are getting them different directions. With the digital, we basically have always referred to PSK as texting over the radio. But it helps them out, at least from their perspective, understand what it is they're looking at. Because, heck, I've walked into satellite stations. I've been a ham radio operator for 30 years, and I still don't know what some of
this. Yeah, how does this all work? So Geist, is Brian putting you all to shame, or do you have some competition here for him?
Well, I know we got competition.
I know my stuff is just thrown in at the last minute. We're going to try to have some static displays and stuff like that. I'm trying to see if anyone in town has some ARDF gear, because we could probably do that in the park that we're at. But right now it appears we're just going to have the stations and probably just some informational stuff. We're only going to do it for 4 hours, 5 hours, I believe, is on the schedule. So it's about all I could do with a few volunteers that kind of stood up and said they would come in and help us out and help create this event. So we're going to try that, and hopefully we can get enough interest in it from the ham radio side and the community here. And I'm in Billings, Montana. I'm hoping we get enough interest in it to kind of drive it forward. You know, it really takes a group of interested people and, true volunteers that really want to bring this program to the scouts and have an interest in growing the hobby beyond themselves.
Yeah, I was just thinking, maybe we have scared people away with all that Brian is doing, because they'll say, we can't do that much. So Bill, it's good that you're...
To the credit of my team, though, we've been doing this for about 6 years. So we've been building on and on and on. So yeah, I think that we may be a little more advanced in that structure, but it's not something we've thrown together quite quickly.
Well, I think in our case, we're going to do the merit badge class. So the thing to... There's some process you have to go through to be a merit badge counselor. And so you need to talk, if you're not in scouting, you need to understand that process. But so we'll have those materials, which are all available on the K2BSA website, by the way, if you want to just see what that consists of and the topics that are covered. I think any ham radio operator would find that interesting. And really how much knowledge is imparted to these kids. So there'll be two pieces. We'll have the merit badge offered, which would be the Boy Scouts, clearly, and the Cub Scouts and Weeblos that would come would have a shorter station tour. And so this station my son has set up, and he's set out to one-up me. He has a two-story shack, and so the top story is where we'll do the classroom, and the bottom is where we'll have the radio set up. And we will also have the coordination that we're doing, and he's doing most of this part, is local hams to be on standby if, we have some CME event or some bad conditions that we really can't demonstrate through long distance QSOs, we'll have some folks there to make sure we do it. We also, we did a bit of this at the Jamboree, and we did it under sort of the banner first of Summits on the Air, but that's not the point, is to show the relevance of radio in a campout. I mean, sometimes they come and see a station in a home, a big shack, and said, I can never afford this. But here's a portable thing, take out and put a piece of wire on a fishing pole and hook it up to a radio and actually make contacts. And we did that at the Jamboree. And, you know, some of the stuff that I use, you know, and I guess is this big. I mean, that's as big as it gets. And so, you know, this is a couple hundred bucks if you want to buy it. And now it's Morse code, and that's down the road. But there's also some portable radios you can use that have sideband on them. Use a portable battery and set them up in a tent, and you're able to make contacts. It adds relevance of radio to the camping experience as well. So we'll have some of that display. You know, not necessarily here's how you do it and in depth, but look, if you're interested, when you can do this on your campouts. And so most of my son is Scoutmaster, and most of his campouts he will take a little radio set up with him. And you know, they don't spend a whole lot of time on it, but it's a little sideshow from time to time for the boys that are interested. So we'll have the radio merit badge, we'll have the operation, we will have the Cub Scout We Blow tour piece of it. To satisfy whatever they want to do, talk however they want to do it. And then we'll have the portable display to just say, here's what it looks like at a campsite.
Are most JOTA operations field day like? Set up outdoors and tents and stuff? Or
I think it varies. Probably as many, you know, you got five different people here, as many people have different setups. You know, I've done, this will be my fifth year of JOTA, and you know, we did two out of our church, and we did one on a car camping trip, and actually the last one I did was a backpacking trip, and so we carried along some, you know, QRP stuff and some handhelds and a couple of UHF VHF directional antennas, and we worked what we had based on where we were.
Yeah, it's not really, whether it's indoors or outdoors. Jim spoke about it before, and we've definitely harped on it. You know, you bring the radios and the gear to where the scouts are. Yeah. And that's really the key. And it's like, if you can have them come to your clubhouse, great. You know, a good friend of ours, Bill Webb, N4WB, down in Tampa, they used to always have a JOTA event at the big Tampa Amateur Radio Club's clubhouse. And they have an awesome setup there with two large towers, TH-11, DXs, or everything else. I mean, they could talk to anywhere in the world on there, but they were having problems of, you know, getting the scouts to come to them. And so they finally decide, you know, we're going to go to the scouts. So the I think the Gulf Ridge Council or whatever the new council is down there, they had some restructuring. They have spookeries at the same time as JOTA. So they just show up at the spookery, set up all the gear, and boom, there's their pop-up jamboree on the air.
What is a spookery?
Spookery, it's, it's an event they put on for the Cub Scouts. The Boy Scouts set up Halloween stuff, you know, like a haunted house thing, and they'll set it all up in a camp. So it's like they pop it up on a camp. The Boy Scouts will run as the staff for the camp, and then the Cub Scouts come in and they just enjoy doing the stations and everything else that goes on in the camp and stuff like that. So it's really a fun event. I used to be part of that council down there when I lived in Florida, and I've attended several spookeries. That's a great event. How an established organization like the Tampa Amateur Radio Club moved from offering the Jamboree on the air at their location, hosting an event, and then they decided, hey, let's do it field day style and let's bring it to the scouts. You know, all the scouts are going to be here. It's much easier to go where the scouts are than to bring them to you.
So yeah. The spookery thing is it on JOTA weekend?
Yeah, it just happens to be on the
just
calendar
before Halloween.
So. Yeah,
yeah. Okay. Do people do JOTA style things outside of the JOTA weekend?
Absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely. We do.
Absolutely.
We do.
Ever. I get calls all the time. We have a website where people can register their events that they're doing for radio scouting, scota.us, scota.us. It's a great website where people can put their events on the calendar and say, hey, we're doing a pop-up station at my troop campout, or we're doing a pop-up station, this weekend at a camporee. We had the weekend before, we had the big event over in Kansas City at the Kansas City 500. So there's always events going on involving radio scouting, and they're tracked either on the SCOTA site or on the K2BSA site when they register to use the K2BSA call sign for their event. And Jim manages that and approves all of that. So he's kind of like the barrier to entry to to using the K2BSA call sign. And we announce all those events as often as we can. We try to get them out on amateur radio newsline and of course on the social media as best as we can.
So you guys, I know that David does. Yeah, the rest of you guys, campouts are a big part of Boy Scouting. And David, you take ham radio along to some extent.
Yeah, I take ham radio along everywhere I go. I take my ham radio to work. But when we go scouting, in fact, I was a ham radio operator before I was involved in Boy Scouts, and I only came into Boy Scouts in my 40s when my son joined. And my first outing was a backpacking trip, and my son needed an adult to go along because he was, friends of. He wasn't quite old enough to join, and we went along. And I had my ham radio, and they used FRS, and the radio I carry around is a commercial, that I'll do ham and the other bands, and I'm listening along, and the FRS only goes so far, and I'm able to help kind of bridge the gap, and everybody was really interested in knowing, well, how did you do that, and what is that technology, and what do you know about all that, and since then I brought a lot more amateur radio to our troop. Pretty much every outing we go, whether it's a car camp or a backpack, there are at least HTs along. When we car camp, I will bring even my HF along, and I have a 30-foot tower that's in a bag that we can set up and put up when the scouts are interested in doing it. And it's kind of hit or miss. Sometimes they want to do it, and other times they'd rather play cards or run around or do whatever they want to do.
Because they're kids.
Yeah, absolutely.
So absolutely. The rest of you guys find FRS radios to be any kind of a bridge between people using their cell phones and getting into ham radio? Something that the scouts can use on their own?
I don't personally use them myself, no.
Is it like
FRS? It's like crickets.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, if they're available, I guess we'd use them. Most of the amateur radio stuff that I've done on campouts, in fact, I was just on one yesterday. I always want to bring the radio, and sometimes I do, but most of ours are pretty high adventure where we're doing a lot of backpacking and stuff. And I have to consider, do I want to carry extra food or do I want to carry my ham radio?
Yeah.
And I'm not getting any thinner. So sometimes, the ham radio stays at home.
Okay, so there's a new concept here that someone needs to jump on. Edible ham radio.
Yeah, that'd
work. Operate it on Saturday and eat it on Sunday.
Yeah, make it like the antenna out of licorice or something. You know, that'd work.
Yeah, you have to work on the conductivity a little bit, and that's probably going to end up being poison. Let me take a look at the K2BSA website, some of the stuff that that you were talking about in terms of material that you can get. Are down here. So for those of you that are looking at the video, it's right on the front page. And there's I discovered in looking at that there's a little JOTA introduction video that I'm going to play.
A Jamboree on the air and Jamboree on the internet.
Okay, I recognize that voice.
We're going to answer the questions. Yeah. What is JOTA, Jody? How does it fit in scouting? And where can you sign up? JOTA Jody is scouts engaging in conversations across the country and around the world. They get a glimpse of other cultures and regional differences. They get exposed to technology, fun, and just magic. It's the largest scouting event in the world, with nearly 1 million scouts participating across 150 countries. It includes all scouts, Boy Scouts and Girl Scouts, and it's always the third weekend in October. Jamboree on the Air uses amateur radio to communicate with other scouts. It uses all aspects of amateur radio from shortwave to satellites. It requires a licensed operator, but ham radio clubs are eager to provide support. Jamboree on the Internet uses a computer and the Internet to communicate with other scouts. There are online chat rooms hosted by ScoutLink. Skype and social media are other active channels, and there are many online games and challenges to keep scouts engaged. So how does it fit in scouting? Well, of course, there's a patch and awards. The annual USA and World JOTA Jody patches are available. The Arrow of Light has a JOTA requirement, and the International Spirit Award also has a requirement. Plus, it extends a scout's outlook on the world. So where can you sign up? Your council or district may already have one or more JOTA Jody locations, or you can get your unit involved. Start planning now by reaching out to local amateur radio clubs. The ARRL has a Find a Club website to help you. There are many online resources as well. The go-to websites are scouting.org/JOTA or scouting.org/JOTI. There's the World JOTA Jody website, ScoutLink, and K2BSA. The next steps are check your council, district, and unit for their local JOTA Jody plans. Start your own plans. Reach out to a local amateur radio clubs and get them involved. And set up your facilities to handle either JOTA, Jody, or better yet, both. That's Jamboree on the Air and Jamboree on the Internet. Don't miss out.
I don't know about this internet thing. I think it's a fad. Don't know if it's going, don't know if it's going
and that,
anywhere.
And as you could tell, that was the focus or the audience was a scouting audience. People who, there's a lot of interest now with those requirements on those new badges, particularly the Weeblos badge. And they're going, how do I reach out? How do I find somebody to help me with this? So that's the audience. I'll also mention on the same website under the menu under Radio Scouting, far down at the bottom, there's an article called Apply Ham Radio to All Scouting Activities. So that's what we were talking about earlier is how do you use this in all of the rest of the activities that, that you have underway? So lots of resources on the website, and you can listen to me, too.
Well, maybe to motivate Bill a little bit, I went on Philmont Trek last year with my grandson and son, and we did 84 miles. And we activated two of the summits there, one over 12,000 feet, one around 10,000 feet. And I had to carry that radio around 2 weeks, and it displaced a lot of calories. Yeah.
So, some advantages. I'm trying to make this come up with the Apply Ham Radio, and it's okay. I'm not sure that
quite
got it. Yeah.
Yeah, the site's been acting up a little lately.
All right, yeah, so. I just pulled it up, but yeah, it'll work.
Right. I think with all things, you know, my experience has been the key to having a successful outing or event like this. And I've done five of these so far, is looking at your ham community and seeing who in that organization, who in those groups can really work with the youth, because not everybody can, and really understanding, you know, who can talk to the kids or the scouts, who understands how the scouts work, you know, who can bridge the technology to, you know, that 12, 13, 14, 15 year old mindset so that they understand what's going on. Cause not all the hams out there can do it. You know, I bring our Aries group along, but I know when I have six or eight people show up, there's two or three of them that may be able to work with the scouts, but the other ones are going to be, you know, limited to, we'll set up the antennas. We'll make sure that the generator has power. We'll make sure everything's connected and working. But you really have to, like, you know, apply that people knowledge too around what can work and what can't work.
It's a very diplomatic way of putting it. Yes.
Yeah.
There are some people that can't deal well with children.
Yeah.
And especially in the scouting program. And it's important. So if you're going to run an event where you're going to have, you know, children involved, you know, anywhere from a first grader up to a high schooler, you know, it really takes an individual that can communicate well not only on the radio, you know, they might be able to do a marathon run event, or they may be able to do a earthquake exercise or something like that on Aries. But, you know, these people have to be able to interface with people right in front of them and then get them to connect to the radio next to them. And they have to not only do that, they have to canvas the person on the radio to make sure that they want to talk to the kid behind them. So it's actually quite a juggling game that they have to play. So, I mean, it really takes a unique individual that can do all of this and make it happen. And, you know, really, you know, once you find those people, you want to hold on to them and get them at every single scouting event. It's really amazing to watch it happen. And I had a great experience, my first national Jamboree this summer here with Jim and Mike, and you know, watching some of these guys do this, it's just amazing. And I'm sitting here supposed to be taking pictures of all this stuff, and I'm just watching. I'm like, wow, you know, these guys are like pro. You know, they really can talk. They can, you know, really translate everything into something that the kid can understand. And you know, we're talking, you know, guys that are, you know, they're not young. We got some 70-year-olds and stuff like that. They're talking with these, you know, little 14-year-olds. And man, these kids are just glued on them. You know, they can't take their eyes off them. They can't stop listening to what they're saying and stuff like that. So it does take a unique person to bridge that gap and make that event successful. Because if you have a bunch of people that can't talk to kids and maybe, you know, maybe can run a net control once in a while, they're not going to make your event really successful. So you really want these people that can just talk and communicate and engage the user behind the radio and, you know, on the radio.
That may be something that is teachable, trainable, may just be a skill you have to have. Bill, is there any specific ideas you've got for learning how to be able to do that? Did you pick up tips from watching these guys?
Oh, yeah. I mean, you know, I definitely enjoyed watching them. Picking up tips, you know, I think it just takes a unique personality. It, you know, it's probably common, but not everybody wants to do that. So, you know, sometimes just throwing out the invite, you know, blind invites to amateurs to come out to your event and, you know, help participate and stuff like that. You know, sometimes, you know, you're going to have them work on the antenna, just like David said, right? You know, because they're not really the right kind of person to engage the person on the radio. Because if they're disinterested with working with kids, they're going to be disinterested in basically doing the whole program. You know, getting the kid engaged with the radio.
It's important. It's a great point. And actually, we did a big scout expo here in Southern California about 12 or 16 months ago. And, you know, I put out a call to the Aries group like I always do. You know, volunteers come and help and set up. And, you know, again, I know that, you know, if I get 12 that will show up, 3 or 4 can work with the youth and the other ones are doing other things. And we just put them to work doing it. And we had such a different group of people show up than usually show up for a hospital drill or an earthquake drill. And, you know, some of them were great and very engaged with the youth, and some of them not so much. And it's always interesting to see, you know, who comes and who wants to participate in those ways. And I talked to a couple of them and they said, hey, you know, they love to see the kids get involved. And, you know, they have grandkids of their own, some of them, and they want to see what the opportunities are. And it's great to see when they do show up and they can help out.
So I'm getting the impression that once again, we're chasing people away rather than bringing them in, because they'll say, I don't think I can handle talking to the kids, you know, in an effective way. How good do you have to be?
I think that you have to basically ask questions of the boys. You know, my experience in seeing them on the air is that when you ask a yes or no question, you're going to get a yes or no answer. But mm-hmm. if you relate to the boy, you know, hey, I was a scouter as well. You know, what do you enjoy most about scouting? You're going to begin to draw answers out of them. And all of a sudden they're going to start having a conversation with you. And that helps out tremendously. The operators that are on the other side of the conversation, the ones that are in the QSO, that are away from the Jamboree station, you know, remember to, you know, when they begin to share their own scouting experience, oh, I was a Cub Scout, you know, back in 1974, you know, they begin to talk about their adventures and that it relates to the kids. And then we usually try to make sure that the boys prompt them with a question, well, what rank did you achieve? You know, were you an Eagle? And it carries on the conversation. And the next thing you know, that young man that's sitting beside you has carried on a 10 or 15 minute conversation that with someone that he can connect to because that person also was a scout. So I think making sure that you're asking those open-ended questions, even if you're not a scouter, you know hopefully enough about the program to where you can ask the boy a simple question, how many kids are in your troop? What school do you go to? What's your favorite subject? And it brings out the conversation.
Because I have heard a lot of fairly tortured on-air conversations during JOTA and other youth activity, kids day, things like that, where the hams just have a real hard time coming up with the conversation. Of course, hams have a hard time coming up with conversation with other hams. That's a typical complaint.
We always prep them. I always have a clipboard with, a bunch of kind of canned generic questions, how old are you and what rank are you and how big is your troop? Those kind of, generic questions. And I really try to talk to the operator on the other side, are there scouts there with you? Great. I'm going to put my scout on and you put your scout on and let the scouts talk. And then again, I make sure that the scout looks at the list and on the clipboard. And, if they don't know what to say other than hi, because that's usually the first thing that they say, hi. And then that's all they say is like, okay, go to the clipboard and, tell them your name and tell them who you are and where you go and all those things. And a lot of times it takes a couple of back and forth, but eventually they'll grasp it and they'll move on. And some of them, they won't. And they'll be like, okay, that was fun. And I'm going to go run around. But there's usually a couple of them that'll be like, oh yeah, I want to talk on the mic and I want to do this. And how do I get my license? And those are the ones that I want to like grab hold of and, get in and I will give my card and I'll give them the thing for our amateur radio merit badge class that we do, on a regular basis. And also here's how to get your 1-day tech license because they will get a license.
So when I was doing the interview with Jerry and Amy at Tapper, and I asked them about the way of get more women and girls into ham radio, Amy's instant response was, well, I see all kinds of Boy Scout stuff going on, but I don't see a lot of Girl Scout stuff going on. So
there's a program. And, I wanted to jump in when I watched the show that you taped with the two of them because I wasn't there. And there's a whole program that the Girl Scouts have. Now, sadly, I did offer to put it on for my daughter's troop when she was participating. The program they put together is what they call a journey in Girl Scouts, which is weeks or months worth of activities. And it's just so complicated that it's hard to really deliver. It's like 5 radio merit badges for the Boy Scouts. And it's just too difficult to pull off. It was my experience. And I don't know if anybody else has looked at that, that's in the group there. Anybody else work with Girl Scouts or have any experience with that?
We've had Girl Scouts that have come to our units, come to our Jamboree on the air, but we've never been able to work with our local Girl Scout Council to deliver a program. No.
They put a whole program together. If you print out the workbook or the sheet or whatever, it's some 70 whatever pages. And it's very, very involved and it's a very, very long process. And it has some of the, you can do this or that, but it's like 25, you could do this or that, or you could do this or that. And it does take so much time that when I approached our local troop that they thought it would just be too much time.
I will note that at the world level, of course, Jamboree on the Air, Jamboree on the Internet is organized by the World Organization of the Scout Movement. And in most countries, it's a co-ed scouting program, not so in the U.S. But at the beginning of 2016, the World Organization of the Scout Movement and the World Association of Girl Guides, Girl Scouts signed a memorandum of understanding to work together. And one of those activities is Jamboree on the Air, Jamboree on the Internet. So our registration system and et cetera all takes into account that as a Girl Scout, you can participate in Jamboree on the Air, Jamboree on the Internet. So it's moving to involve them more. And there's an official path for them to be involved as well. And then finally, I'll mention, I don't know much about it, but it's called Thinking Day on the Air, which is a Girl Scout activity. They have this Thinking Day, and then they also have Thinking Day on the Air. That's all I know about it. I'm not familiar with it at all.
So I'll raise a question and see if I can cause any trouble here. When you guys discuss being attacked by a cat, this is Washi, by the way, he's our new co-host. When you discuss maybe technology issues, Boy Scouts, you know, and technology issues with your counterparts in Girl Scouting, do you get a warm reception? Is it stereotypical? Well, we don't think the girls will be interested in this. And I'm sure it's all over the map, but what have you encountered?
I was the recent past president of the Alamo Area Council. We have a congenial relationship with the Girl Scout organization here, but it's at a very high level. We share camps with them. We allow them access to some of our resources, but really not any programmatic things do we cross. So it's you know, because we have a single purpose in helping youth, and so that's our common ground, and we work as much as we can to organize our resources. But it's still an arm's length type of relationship.
Do you think we'd be better if things were combined more, or if they were kept separate and just, you know, maybe encouraged technology and, you know, gave them whatever assistance that they needed in adding technology to their programs? Because we don't have any Girl Scout leaders on this show, so we got to carry the ball here right now.
Well, I'll only mention this. There is a move afoot by the Boy Scouts at examining, you know, having a girls program, but it's just at that stage at this point. There's been some pushback, obviously, from the Girl Scout side of things, and it's still up for discussion. So who knows where that will end up, and there may be some compromise along the way to what finally comes down. But I think there is some thinking that there's advantages. There are some Boy Scout programs that are co-ed now, mm-hmm. Venture Cruise, and so they've grown and provided some growth for Boy Scouts. So that could be an avenue where some things could some opportunities for girls to participate in some Boy Scout type activities.
In the other countries that are co-ed now at that level, how's that working out?
Well, you know, I don't have any intimate knowledge of that. There's anecdotal knowledge. I think the general consensus is it's probably good at teenage years to keep them separate for obvious reasons. I think generally speaking, though, it works pretty well. Yeah. They don't have the competing organizations internationally that we'd have here. And so it does make it a little easier to organize. So I think anecdotally, it probably works pretty well. And as if anything, the devil's in the details.
Okay. Well, we'll toss out the challenge to Girl Scout leaders. And you're welcome to be on Ham Radio now. I'd love to hear from you. I want to take a moment and drop over on YouTube. There's a lot of videos out there that people have put up for Jamborees on the Air. And I am going to pick one at random. This looks pretty good, random thing here. Okay, you say you're 10 years old. Okay, good to hear. Welcome to Amateur Radio and the name of hearing from R-O-B-E-R-T. And I am from the little town here called Reavers, Virginia. Big to big town, R-E-V-A, about 50 miles south of Washington, D.C. A little town here called Coffee, there, over. So they got a good line. It looks like Cub Scouts.
All right.
Next. Yep.
Yeah, those are tigers.
And it sounds like a very enthusiastic guy on the other end of the radio.
That's all it takes.
Anthony Gallius. I'm 7 years old.
Okay, nice to meet you there, 10 years old. Welcome to Amateur Radio. Go out and pick you up a picnic and book and study for the
just give them your first name and your last name. You have a day, baby.
Mom and Dad was very nice to meet you.
Say thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Well, make sure you mind your manners and tell him thank you for talking to you, okay?
Right, go ahead.
My name is Jeremy Pittman.
You say your name is Jeremy?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, nice to meet you there, Jeremy. Nice to meet you. The name here is Robert, R-O-B-E-R-T. And I am located here in a little town here called Reba, Virginia.
Victor Victor Alpha, RDA, about 60 miles south of Washington, D.C., and a little down here.
Just south of Washington, D.C.
Well, I think you can see the book study, but then you can
So maybe that guy on the air is a little bit too verbose, and he's not giving the scouts quite enough time to talk.
Thank you, sir. No, it's fine. It's great.
Sometimes that works.
Yeah. Especially the young guys. I mean, these are all first graders, so they're not your most talkative group.
Right.
Yes, it's Britton Bagley.
So it looks like the on the air station was sort of a preset guy. I don't think they ran into him at random.
It very well could have. It actually happens that way. Yeah, it does happen that way.
Sometimes you ask them to stick around and they will.
Yeah.
It's like, hey, I got like five scouts here. You want to talk to them? Oh, yeah, sure. I'll hang in there. And they'll just keep on the conversation.
He was ready to go.
Yeah. And they'll tell you all, I was a Boy Scout and I made it to star. I did this. And they're more than happy to give back. Are you still good?
Okay, yeah, go ahead and bring three more in. Oh, yeah.
We'll do it.
Yeah, see? Yeah. You did.
His name's Robert.
Hey, Robert. My name's Tristan.
Now, there's the guy who's going to become a ham.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He wants to have the background information.
Yeah.
Who am I talking to?
Well, it's like, hey, Robert. You know, it wasn't, hi. Yeah.
Well, he's a bear, so he's a little bit older. And the Junior Weeblow behind him.
Yeah, the Weeblow is going to be interesting to see how he does.
Yeah.
There's a little girl back there waiting her turn.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't think the video is going to get that far.
Thank you.
Yes,
thank you.
Yeah.
Okay,
you're
certainly
welcome there,
Kristen,
and
I hope
you
have
lots of
fun. I'll fix it.
I didn't close yet. I didn't close.
And I'm not done.
That's right.
I
was trying to sell him some popcorn.
Yeah. We didn't do the over and out yet.
Yeah.
All right. So is that a pretty typical, line
for
them
the
up and run
guys,
them through?
Yeah.
Cub Scout group rolling through. That's real. Yeah. You do as best you can, get them just to talk a little bit. If they want to talk a little bit more, you let them talk a little bit more. You know, if they start dancing around there in front of the radio, well, it's time to move on to the next one.
Yeah. Well, I mean, if you've got a lot of people that want to participate, I guess you can't give anybody, let them monopolize things. So tell me some stories about some of these activities over the past couple of years. Anything stand out as, wow, this really worked, or my God, that was a disaster? Crickets. Crickets.
I've had both.
Yeah.
I get calls from my local HRO manager, and he'll say, "Hey, somebody came in and they were asking about Jamboree on the air weekend. I know you're going to do it. Can I give them your phone number?" And I said, "No, don't give them my phone number. Give them my email." And we had not last year, but the year before, we did an overnight car camp out at Sage Ranch, which is overlooks the San Fernando Valley, but it has some altitude. And I had I think he was a general class operator, maybe an extra, call me up and said, well, his grandson was going to be doing Jamboree on the air in Pennsylvania. And do we think that we had the equipment that we'd be able to talk to him? And, I said, maybe. and he came out, and we were in a place that still had cell phone reception. So, he called his grandson, and I set him up with a couple of my adults that work well with youth. And they said, okay, well, we can try, try this or we'll try that. And they hopped on. And I don't remember if they hit 80 meters or 40 meters, but I know they were using my G5 RV. And the grandfather and the grandson, they probably had a 20-minute conversation. And they had 20 people standing around them just in awe. Well, you're talking to somebody and they're in Pennsylvania on the other coast? And you can hear them like that? And that's what really drives the excitement and the engagement.
Yeah, we've had similar experiences. We've the past few Jamboree on the airs. I didn't do last year, but I did the last 2 years before that. We have used to have the fall camperee at this little park right next to the Yellowstone River. It's devoid of cell phone coverage and repeater coverage, so it's only HF. So, and of course, in the past few years, we've had really poor band conditions. So trying to get some of these scouts on the air has been a little problematic, trying to get them to have those, you know, long engaging contacts. So I ended up reverting to QSO parties, because QSO parties are running the same exact weekend. So
pretty much
so
every
what I do
weekend.
Is I end up. Yeah, exactly. So I end up printing whichever QSO party is happening on that weekend. I always have the map ready with all the counties, and that's my backup plan. It's like, if we can't do anything else, we're going to work every county we can in these state QSO parties. And, you know, the kids really, they really enjoy it, because it's not really, you know, it's not like confrontational. It's very anonymous. They, you know, they're saying 5-9 Montana, you know, copy and call signs.
But there's a challenge to it.
Yeah, it's a little bit of a challenge. I kind of explain to them, hey, this is a sport. You know, this is a, you know, this is an aspect of the hobby that a lot of people are involved with. Not everybody likes it. Some people hate it. But, you know, hey, this is one of the things that amateur radio is doing. You know, people test their equipment by doing, you know, radio sport, or they, you know, brag because it's fun. and the kids get a blast out of it, because, you know, you get them on for like, you know, one contact, like, oh, I want to do another. Okay, well, go ahead and we'll just, you know, a little search and pounce, find another one. Okay, work them. Can I do another? Yeah, sure. Okay, well, let's just roll down the dial. Another 2.5 kilohertz. Okay. Okay, just next. Okay, you have to go. Okay.
No. Yeah. I want to do another one.
It's dark. Exactly.
Come back when I don't have so many kids in here waiting in line to, you know, work a QSO party. But I mean, you could do almost anything, you know, with all these digital modes, just like you were holding your DMR radio up, D-Star, Echo Link. You know, we can get around the whole problem with, you know, doing an international contact with the propagation conditions that we have now. So, you know, there's really, it's really no excuse to not be able to get these scouts talking to other countries and stuff like that. If you're in an area where you can only do HF, by all means do HF and do it any way you can. You know, do FTA, do PSK, do RIDI, do, you know, do CW, right? Mike would be right at home with CW up there. And, you know, get on there, do voice, do QSO parties. You know, if you can't find another station on 290, you know, join a QSO party. You know, the point is to get these people, these kids and scouts exposed to amateur radio and by any means possible. I mean, we have all these tools at our you know, disposal that we can use in the amateur radio community.
Well, you know, Gary, you asked early on about other times other than Jamboree on the Air, and I don't know how much you other guys do this, but we try for field day, for instance. I always try to get some number of my scouts out, and we put it out in our local council to say, hey, you know, there's field day happening at all these different locations, and, you know, if you're a scout, go out, because there's almost always a JOTA station and they can get on. And I'll have a number of scouts that will show up. And those are the ones that I try to hook. Those are the ones that I'm like, okay, well, come sit on the radio and come make a contact. Cause you know, I'm an older guy in my 50s. And when I put out my call, I might get answered. But if you put a 12-year-old, you know, that either sounds like a YL or sounds like a, you know, a youth, and they put out your call, there, somebody's coming back to them, you know?
Yeah.
And you're going to make those contacts. And when the kids get the response, they're like, oh, like you said, oh, I want to do that again. Oh, can we do that again? Can I ask somebody else? And yeah, as long as there's nobody sitting behind you and there's no somebody else that wants to run that radio, like, yeah, we'll get on the go-to station and you run all you want until you make your 100 points.
You get that that kid that is really digging it. And then you've got some kids behind him that deserve a turn, but they're not quite so interested. Can you get that kid back?
You can sometimes. It all depends. You know, the ones that really dig it, I make sure they walk away. You know, the ARL makes some great radio and scouting flyers, and I make sure they go away with a flyer. And then I show them, you know, on my uniform. I don't know if you can see it here on my uniform. You know, I got my amateur radio operator strip, you know, and I show them that, you know, they can earn that by getting their license, or they can get a radio merit badge. And we offer that at field day weekends as well. And, you know, hey, come back at this time and we can, you know, get you working towards that. I'm a merit badge counselor as well. And so we try to get them hooked and into it. And, you know, all the guys in my troop know that if they get their ticket, you know, I buy them the $2 patch, you know, out of my own wallet. And the ones that have them, they wear them really proudly. And they also know too, you know, as long as they get that strip and they earn that strip, and mom or dad will, you know, go out and buy them a $40 Baofeng that when we go on any outing, they can carry it around and they can use it.
Yeah. I guess, Brian, that's an advantage that you got with all the stations you set up is not quite so much urgency to get somebody off and let the next kid come in. You can spread them out.
Yeah, we do. And I think that you still find that the kids will stay on and listen, you know, as the operators are working someone. We had one a few years ago out at our resident camp where we lucked into the USS Lexington and they were working a special event and they stopped what they were doing. And they said, we've got scouts, guys, we're going to work these scouts for a while. And they plowed through, you know, five or six boys, and it was fantastic. At our Jamboree station, we still find that the kids will huddle around. A couple of years ago, we were working on PSK. We actually worked the National Scout Museum down in Dallas, and they just sat there glued to it. So, you know, the kids, we don't necessarily run into a situation where we're losing anyone. But we do try to keep them engaged and, you know, and the kids are actually pretty good. Hey, I'm tired. Anybody else want to give it a try? And it works out okay.
Do these guys get the concept of radio very much? We all understand the magic of radio. When cell phones and all that stuff came along, their tools are interesting, but they don't get us the way radio does. Now, can you translate that to very many of these scouts?
I think it's the same magic with them still. Having sat through a couple of weeks of Jamboree and watching boys come through, you know, there are still those boys that, you know, it's the same magic. We had one boy that I remember, it was very early on a Jamboree, already had his ticket, but obviously didn't have a station to work at. And he came in and we had these little QSO cards where they could record their QSOs. We had space for five on there. And most boys were good to do one, maybe two. This kid left after 2 hours with like 20 QSOs. And, you know, he was mid-teen, maybe 14, you know, probably into video gaming and all that kind of stuff. And yet here he was so eager, and you could see in his eyes and his attentiveness that he was just eating this up. And I think it's, you know, once the concept is understood, and probably for all of us, I know for me, I can sit in my shack and talk to a guy across the world without any hard wires. It's just magic. We overuse the word. But I think the same thing, and it's our job just to expose them to that. And I think those that have the same curiosity about it that we did will bubble up. And ones who aren't interested, they want to get the requirements done and get the merit badge, they want to move on and do something else. But there are those that will hang around and they're just as excited, just as eager as I was.
How about the rest of you guys? Is there a element of, I could do that on my phone or I could do that on Skype? Or do they get the idea that there's something different going on here?
I think they get the idea there's something different. When you run into, you know, we've commented earlier how the band conditions have not necessarily been in our favor the last couple of years. But still, when you snag someone that's a good distance away, you know, so for us in the Chicago area, if we say, oh, we're talking to Massachusetts, they still go, oh, my goodness, that's pretty amazing. And I think it actually gets a little interesting because you brought up the FRS radios earlier. Well, a lot of the scouts are familiar with those radios. They've seen them. And then when they see our HTs, they say, well, that looks pretty similar. And we actually went to a Boy Scout troop the other night and did a demonstration. We actually brought a DMR radio and, we got on the Worldwide Talk Group and worked a fellow that was in England. And they're like, wow, my radio doesn't do that. So they clearly got the idea that there was something special and different about the process. And you actually do find kids that will begin to ask a lot of those extra questions. And I think converting those kids now into, you know, a potential licensee is really the next step. You know, how do you do that? And how do you get them to commit the time? Because you know, I'm pretty sure the other gentleman will admit, you know, the kids are pretty overbooked these days, committing to studying mm-hmm. something different. That's a hobby that's going to take you a little while to learn a lesson can be a commitment.
Yeah, and with the kids, I mean, you know, especially with HF radio, and you want to, you know, really explain how, you know, how it works compared to their phone. So you tell, okay, get out your phone, put it in airplane mode, and make a phone call.
Yeah.
You can't make a phone call, can you? Can you send a text? No, you can't send a text either. Okay, so amateur radio is like having a phone in airplane mode. You have to figure out how to make this thing communicate with somebody else without everything in between. And, you know, that's a very easy analogy to give them because they understand that. So, oh, yeah, when you put in airplane mode, nothing works. You know, I have to have that on, you know, when I go into school or something like that. So, you know, I think it's real easy to kind of get them to understand that difference. And I saw, just like Mike did at the merit badge classes over the summer, you know, that's one of the things they go over is that, you know, your phone is great. It's the radio you use every single day, but it's attached to billions and trillions of dollars of infrastructure that allow you to just press numbers on it and make phone calls. You know, without that infrastructure, this thing is, you know, basically for playing video games.
so that reminds me.
What's wrong with that?
There's nothing wrong with that, right?
We've had some things going
on. Games with friends.
we've had some things going on, still going on right now in Houston, yeah, in South Florida, in Puerto Rico, Virgin Islands, where that infrastructure is gone. Does that ever come into play? I mean, Boy Scouts are be prepared.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, for me, it does.
Go ahead.
No, go ahead. Go ahead.
I was going to say we brought up Puerto Rico and the Virgin Islands the other night at a unit, and we told them, you know, 95% of the cell services are out. How do you get a message to your parents stateside? And we actually use C-Base as an example because C-Base, we obviously know, got hit as well. And I said, you know, well, how do you get that message out? And you've got to have something other than that cell phone. And we began to talk about how amateur radio can play a role in communicating. You know, I know that others that take their radios on scouting events. I do the same thing. And they find it fascinating that with a wire and a 5-watt radio, you can have a conversation with someone several hundred miles away. And that makes, you know, when you're out of cell phone range, those kids understand that my cell phone does not work, but somehow that radio Mr. McDaniel has is talking with someone in Toronto. That's really neat. That actually can save lives. And they equate the preparedness component pretty quickly, actually. It's rather surprising.
A couple of you had mentioned other modes besides voice, a little bit of Morse code and some digital modes. How do those translate to interest among the scouts?
We've done RTTY before. And it's interesting they can watch it print. You know, it's something they can observe and not have to say anything. And we can explain while the print's going on. So I think that is an interesting mode for them just to observe. And it allows you to explain it. And they don't have to participate and say something. Morse code, obviously, is a little bit over their heads to start. But I will say you can get an interpreter strip here. For Morse, if you learn Morse code, you Boy Scouts get an interpreter strip. Usually that would say Espanol or Francais or Deutsch or whatever for the language. But so we are tempted to start for boys who are interested, maybe just a code class, and may or may not tie it to radio because it's currently not tied that, but just to teach the skill. But I think that voice digital modes, the FT8, the JT65, we did some of the Jamboree, and the boys are very interested in that. And with FT8 now, it's a minute, I think, for a QSO. And so you can move through a few for them to watch. So I think it's to show them the variety is important, not just one aspect. One thing that fascinated me, and someone mentioned it earlier, we had a satellite station at the Jamboree. I've never messed with satellites, and I was just intrigued watching all that. In fact, I was so motivated that I bought me a little two-band antenna and made my first satellite contact after the Jamboree, just following it across with my hand, which is kind of cool. But I think it's important to have some variety if you can. If you can't, you can't. But I think to the extent you can demonstrate multiple modes, you have a better chance of catching their interest.
The PSK has always been very popular with the boys, at least in our area. My challenge I've run into in Morse code is that I found it's actually pretty good to have a skimmer with me. So it's actually doing the translation, because the second I get, you know, three letters out, either sending or receiving, all of a sudden I'm inundated with 20 voices going, what are they saying? What are they saying? I'm like, well, I haven't gotten there yet, guys. Give me just a minute or two. And so once I, you know, I agree with what he was saying, if you've got something that can show what's being communicated at the time, it sort of takes the pressure off so they can read the conversation and they don't have to necessarily try to figure out what's going on.
Do the digital modes get past maybe some of the mic fright that a lot of people have?
I think it depends.
For some of them. For some of them.
All right. We've been going pretty well here. David, do you have anything you want to toss in that have been boiling in the back of your brain?
No, I think we've covered it well. I'm actually kind of bummed because I have a personal trip that I'm going to be out of town for this particular year. And I'm going to have some downtime and I will bring radio along because it'll be kind of in town up in the mountains. And if and when I do have free time, I'm going to put up a 20 or 40 meter dipole and see who I can talk to just to be able to get out there and make some contacts.
Okay. The hams that are setting up stations don't necessarily have to be Boy Scouts or former Boy Scouts or associated with a troop.
They don't.
You can do it through your local club. You could do it as an individual. Any background checks or any of that stuff?
Not if there's registered leaders present. Generally, we encourage at least the ham radio, you know, our ham radio club that participates with that. I always recommend that they take the youth protection training. That way they understand the policies that are there in the Boy Scouts. You know, they have no one-on-one contact. They have too deep leadership. And when I have events like JOTA where I'm inviting just random groups where they may just send, you know, a scout with a parent and stuff like that, I explicitly explain that it's like, yeah, you need to stay with your scout. This is not a drop off thing. This is going to be, you know, you supervise whoever you bring. You know, I'm covered because I'm a registered leader. I'm a registered merit badge counselor. I'm a committee chair, you know, everything else with the BSA. You know, I have at least two others that are going to be there with the BSA. So, I mean, we could have our own event, but I always say that, you know, if you're going to bring scouts there, whether it's a parent, whether it's a troop leader, whatever, pack leader, you know, you're responsible for your scouts. So, and I always encourage open events where the area is open, like we're having ours at a park. You know, you can have it at a camporee where it's already a scouting event. Mike's having it at his son's place. Which that's kind of a closed event, but you know, if you have enough leaders present and stuff like that, that's fine. I don't really like enclosed spaces too much. I like inviting people to your shack, especially if it's like in a room or like mine's in my garage, as you can see here. It's not a very conducive to having a lot of people in here, so it would probably borderline on, you know, that one-on-one contact. So I don't recommend that. You know, if you can do a portable station, you can do a field day type setup, do it. You know, it's a great opportunity to show them, hey, you know, there was nothing here when we showed up this morning. All of a sudden now we got a station running. You know, we're already talking to people and we brought it all with us in our car. You know, it's such a great thing to also show about the hobby is that, you know, it doesn't have to be in your house. It doesn't have to be in your HOA, you know, place where you can't even have an antenna, you know. I can go to a park in the middle of an HOA place and throw up an antenna.
And the reality is if you can't get out and set up, just getting on the air and looking up the frequencies that the scouts are going to be on and being able to be that other side of the conversation is helpful as well, too. A lot of times my challenge has been just finding people for the scouts to talk to.
Yeah. Yeah. And this is great with JOTA for, you know, to have the DMR. We have the talk groups for that. We have the reflector for D-Star, the, what was that, 33 Alpha there, Jim?
Yes.
We have two Jamboree on the air Echolink conference nodes. So, I mean, we're trying anything and everything to make sure that people can connect on amateur radio means, even if it's through the digital networks and stuff like that.
And this is international, right? It's worldwide?
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
And, you know, and I'll tell you, honestly, the first year we did this, I had no idea what to expect. And, you know, we set up an antenna in the parking lot and some radios, and I brought along a couple iPads and a laptop because we have internet there. And we did the Jamboree on the internet. And honestly, I had 14, 15 scouts show up, and three of them were out with me and one of the other adult leaders that had an amateur radio license. And we were working the HF and some UHF VHF, and all the other scouts were inside on the iPads and the laptops talking to Scotland and Africa and this and that. And they had a great time. They had an awesome time. And somebody kept saying to me, should we go get them and get them out here? I'm like, no, if they're having a good time and they're doing their thing, just let them have at it.
Yeah. People yeah. always say
that's a good program too.
You know, you can use Skype or you can use your phone and talk anywhere, but do people yeah. actually do that very much? I think the radio aspect adds the element of, well, let's actually do it.
You know, the thing that the feedback I got, and you know, one of those scouts that were inside on a iPad was my son, and you know, his comment was it was a lot easier to get on and talk to somebody, and I was able to go from a country to another country to another country, and there was always somebody there, and a lot of it was chat room, and you know, they're so used to doing text messages, so they were able to jump in a chat room and have a text conversation with somebody or multiple people around the world.
Yeah.
You know. And that's, you know, that's what worked for him at the time.
Yeah. So some of that becomes, well, radio is a challenge.
And it can be.
You either, it's a challenge you want to accept and to tackle or not.
Yeah. And you know, and the attention span of a 12-year-old boy is, you know, about 4 minutes.
Yeah.
I usually think it's a goldfish.
Yeah. Yeah.
Anything else from the rest of you guys that you want to?
Yeah, I think the one thing I would say is for the other operator that's on the other side, you know, we're setting up the station, we're putting boys on there. Don't get caught down with jargon. Don't bombard them with phonetics and NATO, NATO stuff. Have a conversation. You know, talk to the boy because you're talking to a 10-year-old. Talk to your grandson. Talk to your son. You know, don't get in there and get, you know, overly technical or start throwing a lot of things. Because I think you saw in the video, you know, as the operator was giving his name phonetically, everyone in this room knows what he was saying, but that scout's like, what in God's name is he saying?
Yeah.
And so you got to remember that these guys aren't the experienced communicators, that they're doing something. So make sure that you just keep in mind that you're talking to a young man that you want to try to draw in.
Yeah. Same sort of things when you're talking to anybody in the public about ham radio, is that you can't jargonize it. You can't be too technical. You need to be very direct about, you know, what it is. Okay. Let's go through a little round robin of, just a little bit of background, where you are and, what your scout troop is and what your position is with it. And maybe a little bit about your ham radio. So Brian, I'll let you kick that off.
Oh, well, thank you. And first of all, thanks very much for the opportunity to be on tonight. I'm really happy to be here, and thanks for the invitation. N4AE, my name's Brian McDaniel. I'm the trustee for K9RSR. That's Rainbow Council in suburban Chicago. So we handle basically the southwestern counties. If you've ever heard of Joliet, Illinois, that is one of the towns that are in our area. I've been licensed since I was a teenager. Most of grew up in the hobby with my family. You know, my dad and my uncle, my grandfather were all licensed very early on. And I think that ham radio has been a part of my scouting experience, many in the way the other guys are talking. You take the radio out there, you use it on hikes, you use it on bikes, you use it as a communication tool. And, you know, if I can bring the hobby to another generation in some fashion, then hopefully I'm doing my part.
Okay. And we're glad to have you here too. Mike, you're up.
Yeah. Well, I would echo, it was nice to be here. I'm now retired. I've been on the board of the Alamo Area Council for about 12 years and recently served 2-year term as president of the council. I've been a ham radio operator for about 29 years. Both of my sons have their tickets. Both of my grandsons, who are 15 and 17, have their tickets. And so we've been in scouting and ham radio. Both of my sons are also Eagles. And my oldest grandson just finished his Eagle paperwork, and the youngest one is about to get his project going. So we've been a ham radio scouting family, and I was a scout. I just got to Star Scout. I didn't make it to Eagle, but since I was in the program, One cool thing that we did, I mentioned the trip to Philmont. I went with my sons 25 years to the day from the day I went with my son and my grandson. So I had two Philmont treks. And if you don't, Philmont's in northern New Mexico, and it's sort of a mountainous region of New Mexico. And
it's a big, big scout camp. Hike.
Yes. And we carried ham radio on the whole 84 miles. And operated it several times while we were on that trek. But, you know, from a JOTA perspective, this will be my third or fourth time to do it. It's been spread out over the years. We've done it field day style. We've done it in the shack as well. And we've, you know, each has its own rewards. And I think the main thing, the two things I'd want to say is obviously from the scouting side, we've talked about all of the advantages and how it fits in the scouting program. But I think also, and I mentioned it earlier, but I'll reiterate it, for radio clubs looking for a way to impact youth, this is a way to do it. It may not be the way to do it, but it's a way to do it. When you have kids focused on a weekend on the air, and you can participate in multiple ways. You can either call your council and participate actively, or you can be on the other side of the QSO and participate in that way. And also, I would suggest some follow-up, you know, get some relationship with your local council. If your kid's interested in getting a ticket, how do they do it? Make yourself available. So it's a great way to get kids exposed and to follow up with those who want to take it a step further. So it's a great program for scouting and for amateur radio.
And Alamo, I take it that's Texas someplace.
Yes, I'm sorry. I'm actually in Boerne, Texas, and that's how we pronounce it here. It's actually spelled B-O-E-R-N-E, but in Texas, that spells Boerne.
What part of the state?
That's northwest of San Antonio, about 30 miles in the Texas Hill Country.
Okay, so you were a long way from Harvey. You felt it a little bit, I imagine. But
yes, I was. We just had a little 3 or 4 inches of rain here, a little bit of wind, but it was nothing dramatic.
Okay, Bill, you're up.
Bill Stearns, NE4RD, and I've been a ham for 23 years now.
Did you specifically pick that call to make it nerd?
Yes, I did.
Okay.
Yeah, when I upgraded to extra, and I think it was 2008 or 2009, I decided I'm going to get a vanity call. I need something just small and lightweight for CW, and of course, none of the 1x2s or 2x1s was available. So I was like, well, let me look for something like geeky or nerdy, and sure enough, NE4RD was available, and it became mine, and nobody else can have it. And I'm in Montana now, so I'm in Seven Land, and I don't sign with Portable 7 because I'm definitely not portable. I'm here, but I'm with the Montana Council here. I'm a committee chair for my local troop. My oldest son just graduated out as an Eagle, and my middle son just likes camping. So he enjoys scouting to that effect. And I was part of the Gulf Ridge Council in Florida before I moved here, and was involved in the committee down there. And I'm also a committee member of the K2BSA just recently. So that's about what I do. I do the amateur radio newsline bits for the K2BSA and radio scouting. And pretty busy guy.
You look like you're seriously set up for podcasting and stuff. Do you do anything like that?
Oh yeah. Yeah. I'm also on Linux in the Ham Shack. So I do that podcast, every other week, and, pretty much anything I get invited to, I'm on.
You'd be like me, anybody who wants me, I'll be.
Yeah. There. Yeah. I'm there, you know, whatever. I try to make stuff happen. I basically try to mule out Jim here most of the time and get him to go around places, and when he says no, I get stuck doing it. So
that show Linux in the Ham Shack is about like 4% Linux and about 96% Ham Shack, I think.
Oh, yeah.
So 5% whiskey.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's some, and some recipes.
Because I can even listen to it. And
I get very hungry and drunk by the end of it. No.
It's a great podcast. No. It really is.
Yeah, yeah. It's fun.
Yeah. And Jim, your turn.
Hey, well, Thanks so much for having us on the on your most important ham radio show. And you've had us on here a few times. We appreciate it very, very much. But I'm K5ND, Jim Wilson, and I've been licensed since 1973 and been very fortunate to align my career with ham radio in many situations. I worked for Heathkit for a number of years and wrote their general class amateur radio course, got a start in publishing there, and worked for Boy Scouts for 20 years, 21 years before retiring. But about 8 years or so ago, the Jamboree on the Air organizer at the national office retired. And they looked around the office and said, who else could do this? Is there anybody that's got a license? And I think I was the only one. So I got to sign up for that extra duty. It became my night job there and a great deal of fun. It was it's been delightful to bring a bit more organization to Jamboree on the Air and the other amateur radio scouting activities that happen. And so, yeah, that's what I do.
All right. Once again, it is coming up. The weekend of October 20th starts on Friday, 20th, 21, 22. And it's not too late if you're Boy Scouts in your area would like to have something set up and they don't already have it, contact your local troop. They're not Council. Probably not that hard to find. Yeah. Give me the right language, David.
Yeah. So, you know, call your local district or council probably, or you can call a local troop, but the district or council will refer you to somebody in your area.
Yeah.
And if you don't know where to go, go to scouting.org and you can find a unit and it'll give you all the contact information for finding the district and scouts and stuff like that.
Yeah. Yeah. David, I guess you can make your scouting connection.
So I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG, the scoutmaster for Troop 22 in our district for the last 4 years, recently committee chair for our venture crew. And father of an Eagle Scout, live in a multi-generational home with 7 people and 5 hams, hopefully one more ham soon. And I don't think my mom's going to ever do it, which is fine.
Maybe though, someday.
Maybe. I don't think so.
All right. And you're co-host of Ham Radio Now.
And I'm co-host of Ham Radio Now.
All right. And I was a Cub Scout and a Weebolo and a Boy Scout briefly, but just not a good fit with the troop I was in long, long time ago. Not a story I remember fondly. Probably would have been better off if I'd gone through the rest of the program, but I didn't. So, but I'm glad to help you guys and promote the activities. How many guys know how the program closes?
I do.
At least Jim's
if it's
been
not
there.
Like the one last
Jim,
time.
Jim's been on. Jim, you know.
Uh-oh.
He's been on so many programs.
I need a cue card for this one, I'm afraid. Well,
there are elements of the audience that this is their favorite part of the show. And so we always try to do something for them. It is bad radio procedure. And so as scouts, I'm not sure I feel comfortable asking you to participate in bad radio procedure. It's a Hollywood form of radio communications. You hear it all the time and might not even recognize that it's bad radio procedure until it's explained to you, as it was so clearly explained to me when I first did it on Ham Nation, that it's bad, but it's bad. I guarantee it's bad. It's an old Dick Tracy, finishing up from 6-2 and even over and out. And what makes it bad is over is your turn to talk. Out is I'm going away. So I always say, well, okay, if I say over and out, it's your turn to talk, but I'm not going to listen. Okay.
A true broadcast.
So Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. If you enjoy the programs, this is a lot of fun, you guys. Stop by. There's Arvin over my shoulder, and David, you got a Arvin over your shoulder.
I think he's over here. I think he's here. There he is.
Yeah. Okay.
I got the autofocus off, so he's there.
he's pretty good. There's the button that gets us all back together again. So the over and out part is the only thing that's left, and I'm going to do a 3-2-1 countdown and everybody all together at once. So here we go. 3-2-1.
Over and out.
Perfect.
Don't we have to sing happy birthday?
Oh yeah, we should do that. No, it's not. When is it, Gary? It's really on Jamboree on the air weekend.
Yeah.
All right. So. We'll get everybody back together in 3 weeks.
Right.
There you go.
I feel a Skype outage coming.
Yeah, we could do a hot wash on how Jamboree on the air went.
Yeah, that's great.
Yeah, that would be a good idea. You guys did great. You had the stories and the how to's are just what I was looking for. So.
Great.
It went very, very well. I really liked the stories. I learned stuff. So very, very good. Thank you.
And I like getting beyond the press release. So
absolutely. Yeah. I mean, you got to go to these guys to get beyond the press release. Very smart. Very wise. Worked very, very well.
All right. And I think, David, we taught some more folks how to operate Skype here. It always happens with a group.
I learned. Thank you.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah. It was new for me.
And it was a good experience for me because I figured out that I must have a problem with my OBS workstation because I've been good on my MacBook the whole time.
I think Keith will let it. I do know that.
And it came up toward the end of the impromptu Facebook Live OBS test.
Of the last session, but this time I couldn't even get in the beginning.
Yeah, you haven't used it since then, I take it.
Most of this was streamed on Facebook, is that right?
Yes, it was live on Facebook.
Oh, Lord.
Yeah. Oh, sorry. We should have warned you.
Nice.
Uh-oh.
Should have self-censored better.
Nobody said anything inappropriate. You're all good scouts. Okay. I'm going to click the Facebook off by Facebook. And I'm going to click the recording off by hard drive